dear Mr. Dingy, dear Mr. Chair of the Center. Ah, yes, could you open it? Distinguished colleagues, dear ladies and gentlemen, dear students, it is indeed a great honor and pleasure to be here today to give this Krishna Bharadwaj Memorial Lecture the 25th, and I am deeply moved by the invitation. I have very sweet memories of Krishna. She was a close friend of my wife and me. She came to Germany, where she gave talks in Bremen. I met her on various occasions in Cambridge, in Stanford, Trieste, Italy. And I know from Safa's unpublished papers that he thought very highly of her and actually helped her to come to Cambridge and work in Europe and elsewhere. He was really a fan of hers, and as you might know, she was invited later on by Pierangelo Garignani, the literary executive of Safa's work, to help her with editing the edition, which unfortunately did not materialize, not least because Krishna unfortunately died so early. I have also a very sad memory of her because when I was a professor at the New School for Social Research in New York, I one day received a phone call from Krishna, and she told me, "Heinz, I do have a brain tumor. I had an operation, and now I can't read and write anymore. I can't see anymore." And that is the worst thing, I think, that can happen to an intellectual who was always fond of reading, writing, commenting on other people's works, and so on and so forth. So that was a very sad moment, and shortly afterwards, indeed, she passed away. Now, today I'm going to give a paper, the Bête Noire, Power of the Bête Noire, much of economics. The history of the paper is the following. I was invited to give a talk in Italy, Lecce, Italy, at a conference of an Italian association of economists, and I chose that title. And it just so happened that I was sent a paper by Amit Baduri, who had been invited to give a talk as a Leontief Prize man on a similar topic. And indeed, there are some similarities between the two talks, the two papers. I've worked ever since in order to complete the piece, and it ought to be published before long. So, Power, the Bête Noire in Much of Economics. It is a fairly long talk I'm going to give, but I have to give it in 1 hour, and therefore I will speak quickly. This helps for the understanding in the audience. And the composition of the thing is the following, as you can read. It's easy, I think, to understand. I will start with a brief remark on general equilibrium theory, and particularly the concept of a competitive economy. Then I will enter into a discussion of various concepts of power. I will briefly say a few words about Thomas Hobbes, who really started a huge discussion on the issue and advocated the absolutist state. Then I will spend more time on Adam Smith, because he had interesting things to say. So did Ricardo and Marx, of course. I will briefly comment on land as power, which is a recurrent theme in economics and the social sciences. I will then give you a brief idea of the view of Eugen von Böhm-Bawerk, a famous Austrian economist, who argued that we need not care about power. And this was, so to speak, a justification for the widespread view that perfect competition is the right assumption to be entertained by economists. I will talk about exploitation in a marginalist framework. I will then conclude basically with Friedrich von Wieser. You might not know the name. He was the brother-in-law of Böhm-Bawerk, and he was countering, so to speak, Böhm-Bawerk's view by a book called The Law of Power. And then a few concluding remarks. So this is the thing, just a few pictures. Krishna, when she visited us in Bremen, a very lively woman, wonderful indeed, an excellent singer, and just a great person and a wonderful scholar. This is showing her with a young gentleman, it seems, and a young lady. Time went by very quickly. On the right-hand side, you see Krishna and me. I think that was in the Yosemite National Park, which we visited. And down there, you see these even scholars occasionally get hunger, and they need some intake. We are eating there, I mean, without good table manners, as the Brits would have, no? Right. Now, introduction. Economics ought to be a science of power, Bertrand Russell, the philosopher, insisted. However, when we look around, we see that there is very little in economics, setting aside some fields where power is being dealt with to some extent, is hardly ever treated. Kurt Rothschild, in his famous Penguin book, pointed out that there's a strange lack of power considerations. Krishna, in her themes in value and distribution, of course insisted, coming from the classical point of view, that power is a phenomenon that must not be neglected because power relationships really dominate the relationship between landlord and tenant, master and worker, moneyed man and investor, and so on and so forth. So power is important. And indeed, one could say that economics, when it was born, so to speak, in the 17th century, basically, it was all about power. One might say, without too much of an exaggeration, indeed, that in the past, all economic discourse was a discourse about power. The mercantilists, but also the classical economists, Marx, etc., etc. Now, the absence of power, as I already mentioned, today is epitomized in the concept of perfect competition, which presupposes a state of affairs in which no agent has any market power whatsoever. We are all equals, right? There is no difference between us. We all have no power. We cannot make other people, so to speak, follow our will. Now, I would like to add that indeed, this is maybe justified to some extent by the fact that power is very often difficult to see. It is hidden. It works secretly. And there are two responses to this fact. The first one is that because of its low visibility, some people believe that there is no power that plays any role. And the second is, of course, that it gives rise, the fact that you can't see it easily, it gives rise to conspiracy theories of various sorts. How to separate the wheat from the chaff in all this? How to find out who pulls the strings? This is a picture taken from a book by John Maynard Keynes, and you can see there is this sinister figure who apparently has power over others, but the others don't really recognize it, despite the fact that they're really controlled by that creature under consideration. So questions asked in this talk will be, what is the meaning of power in economics? What are its sources? What its effects? What did important authors have to say about power in economic affairs? And in particular, what about income distribution? Because power relationships are reflected in particular in the distribution of the product amongst the different claimants, also wealth and other magnitudes. I come to that. Now let me briefly start with a very quick look at general equilibrium theory of the Arrow-Debreu variety. I suppose most of you, to the extent to which you're economists, you're familiar with it. And clearly enough, what we find there is, in terms of method, analytical method, the idea of methodological individualism. That is to say, the theory tries to reconstruct society starting from self-seeking individuals and then discussing their interactions. In good old Menger, Karl Menger, the founder of the so-called Austrian School of Economics, the argument is you ought to study from a person like Robinson Crusoe. Of course, before he met Friday, right? Robinson Crusoe, then, I mean, bring in other characters and then see how they interact. Now, in general equilibrium theory, it is obvious that if you want to have such a theory, you must be sure that the number of agents you start with does not fade away as the argument develops. So you must have a sort of survival condition imposed upon the system, because otherwise you would have to have a new model. Not n agents, but n minus one, n minus two, and so on and so forth. And if you read Arrow de Bray, there is a survival condition given, and it reads as follows: impossible combinations of commodities, such as the consumption of a bundle of commodities insufficient to maintain life, are regarded as excluded from the set. Of course, it means people can survive. They can survive on the basis of the initial endowment of the economy and its distribution amongst the various individuals, right? So that's the assumption behind it. Now, if you look at the general equilibrium that can be derived under quite bold conditions, you will see that equilibrium, depending on the conditions, of course, and the assumptions you make about preferences, technical alternatives, etc., equilibrium is very often almost an autarkic system, semi-autarkic system, and as McKenzie pointed out, with a little trading on the side. This is not exactly what we find in our world, a little trading on the side, but trading is so important that it takes center stage in modern economies. Now, these are results you get in general equilibrium theory, setting aside the fact that all economic activity has to take place in space. Now, let's assume there is space in the most simple configuration you can think of. Then you will see, as David Sterrett pointed out in a paper 1978, that social cohesion, if you wish to call it that way, vanishes in almost entirely when one takes the spatial dimension of economic activity into account. Why? Then the competitive price mechanism formalized by Arrow and de Bray can explain neither the emergence of spatial economic concentration nor extensive trade streams. That is, economic activity will be evenly distributed across a homogeneous plane. Consumers and producers are totally independent of one another. That is, there is no society in any meaningful sense, which is a surprising result, and of course it runs counter to the idea that you reconstruct society as it is, starting from self-seeking individuals and then discussing their interaction. In other words, without contaminating the assumptions of that theory with features of the desired result, right? The exercise amounts to abstraction monitoring. So you must really impose what you want to get already at the assumptions. It's not, so to speak, that innocent activity discussing the homo economicus and its interrelation with others. You must apply assumptions which help you in getting results that really mimic the society you're talking about. In other words, assumptions matter. Some sharpen our understanding of the world, others obstruct it. And one could, of course, apply John Wheeler's famous remarks, the physicist: space is what prevents everything from happening to me, time is what prevents everything from happening at once, and we might add, power is what prevents almost everything from happening in a just and fair way. Right? So, power is there. Now, it's a multifaceted concept of power you come across if you read the literature, and of course, in this talk I can only talk about a few scholars and their thoughts about the issue at hand. All these concepts boil down to the idea that power is an asymmetry in human relations between individuals, groups, or social classes, as the famous sociologist and economist Max Weber, the German, called it. Power reflects the probability that one actor within a social relationship will be in a position to carry out his own will despite resistance, regardless of the basis on which this probability rests. And we shall see there are lots of bases upon which that can rest. Very similar views have been put forward by Herbert Simon or also Robert Dahl. The asymmetry can be explained in the causal way to say that person I has power over person J is equivalent to saying that I's behavior causes J's behavior, not the other way around. However, these definitions, while useful, are too narrow in order to understand certain phenomena, because they do not really touch upon the socio-economic institutions, the legal, political, and cultural systems, and the beliefs or ideology that support a given power structure, and the mechanism by means of which it is reproduced. In short, you would like, in order to understand the phenomenon, to look at the working of the system as a whole, and how dominated strata of society are made to acquiesce to the situation. So you must have a look at the system as a whole, not just, I mean, Mr. A and Mrs. Y and so on and so forth. That may help in partial analysis, but in order to understand the reproduction of power structures in an economy as a whole, you need to go beyond that. Now, Bertrand Russell insisted in the 1930s and even in earlier publications that power, not wealth, should be the basic concept in social theory, because the love of power, he argued, is outweighing all other motives of human action. That's the crucial motive, he argued. Power, like vanity, is insatiable. The love of power is greatly increased by the experience of power. But he also added that, you see, knowledge even is, so to speak, in some sense, a reflection of the love of power. But if knowledge is applied in a good way, so to speak, it need not be detrimental to anyone's interests, but might help many people. So power by itself is not necessarily a bad thing. It can be put to good purpose. And he claimed that social justice should consist in the equalization of power to the greatest practical degree. That was Russell. Now, Thomas Hobbes, the famous author of the Leviathan. Let's very briefly talk about his ideas, because they played an important role in the classical economists' writings, who tried to reject his basic ideas. Now, according to Hobbes, power has two sources. The first one is natural, coming from intellectual eloquence, physical strength, prudence, and so on and so forth. But the second one, and important for the social game, so to speak, is instrumental power. Devices used to increase a person's personal power via wealth, money, reputation, friends, networks, and so on and so forth. Now, Hobbes' construction is as follows. The quest for power is ultimately, he argued, a quest for command over other people's powers. And this idea comes back in Smith, comes back in Marx, comes back in many authors. And of course, one form of joining powers is to buy or enforce the compliance of others. He also pointed out that power is a relative concept. In the presence of someone who is very powerful, everyone else who has less power, so to speak, has now no power at all in the extreme. And he added that there are particular people in each and every society, puer robustus, he called them, which are interested in maximizing, so to speak, their power. And because of that, there is always a tendency in society to fight each other, a permanent struggle for power, each person vying for larger power and seeking to acquire that of others. And that is, of course, what he called the state of nature. In the state of nature, every man has a right to everything, even to one another's body. Now, of course, you see, that is a situation which is really dangerous for people, and his argument was, bellum omnium contra omnes, his argument was, in order to avoid that, all people have to have a monarch, particularly a monarch, an absolutist emperor, an absolutist state, where they hand over their needs for power to that absolute state, and only the state, the absolutist state, can exert power. That was the argument. So what results in the end is the monstrous and fearsome sea creature in the book of Job called Leviathan that ends the state of nature and enforces a condition of social equilibrium by keeping the children of pride in check. So power is very important. It's the basis for his construction of society, and it must be an absolutist society, because otherwise there will be anarchy, chaos, battle, war, and whatnot. Now Adam Smith counterposes Hobbes' vision of an absolutist state, the Leviathan, by a well-governed society. It is possible to escape, so to speak, the Hobbesian absolutist state on certain grounds, on certain circumstances. First of all, Smith was clear that power is rooted in many things. Could be wealth, could be education, information, access to information in particular, race, even sex, etc. That's one aspect. The other aspect in Smith is, he was clear that it is difficult for large groups to organize their interests vis-a-vis small groups. The collective action problem, as we would call it in economics. And then he pointed out that, of course, it's the working of the system as a whole that is responsible for the reproduction of certain power structure or their erosion. That's also possible, because the system moves onwards and the feudalist state will go away, the capitalist state will rise, and so on and so forth. Now, clearly enough, in Smith, the idea that preferences, so to speak, can be taken as given, as in general equilibrium theory, without further examination, is inacceptable, because preferences of agents are very much shaped by the group or the class to which people belong, their upbringing and whatnot. So they are very much conditioned by the social circumstances in which people live. And therefore, I think to claim that Smith can be captured within a general equilibrium framework seems to me to be difficult to sustain. At any rate, The Wealth of Nations, I claim, is a book in which power relationships between social classes and between nations assume center stage. And I shall try to show that in the following. First, Smith on Hobbes. Of course, you have to deal with Hobbes and his doctrine, his social theory, if you want to argue in favor of a market-based economy, a modern society, etc., etc. And Smith believes that this is possible, provided indeed that there is a state, a government, which, I mean, looks after the fact that, I mean, people who are very selfish, who are very rapacious, don't get a free way to execute their wills. Indeed, the Wealth of Nations is explicitly designed to elaborate, as he called it, the science of the legislator that shows the way to good government. That's a difficult task, but that is what Smith wanted to provide. Arguments in favor of good governments as opposed to bad ones. Now, he was decidedly not of the opinion, to be very clear, which frequently, but wrongly, is ascribed to him, that nothing but selfishness is needed to yield socially beneficial outcomes. This is not Smith. Smith was a moral philosopher, and he was decidedly opposed to this view, which is again and again ascribed to him. Actually, he rejected both Mondeville's point of view, which goes in that direction, he was a cynic, and Hobbes. In the theory of moral sentiments, Smith attacked Hobbes by insisting that antecedent to all law or positive institution, the mind was naturally endowed with the faculty by which it distinguished the qualities of right, laudable and virtuous, and in others, those of wrong, blamable and vicious. That is, Smith disputed the very basis of Hobbes' construction, his philosophical anthropology. And he thought that peace and agreeable social affairs cannot be really attained by an absolutist state, but only by a well-governed society which leaves enough freedom to the action of agents. But he agreed, expressis verbis, to Hobbes' doctrine that wealth is power. Wealth is power. And this power translates in Smith into, as he writes, a certain command over all the labor, over all the produce of labor which is in the market. And he adds, the exchange of value of everything must always be precisely equal to the extent of this power which it conveys to its owner. So these are very strong statements, and you see power and labor commanded, I mean, are the central categories. Now, let's do a little formalization. Economists love occasionally formalization, so I have to do it. Labor commanded versus labor embodied. It's very, very easy. You will see it immediately. This is a system of prices a la Smith. Of course, it's a Schraffian reconstruction of the classical theory, but I take the liberty to use it. And it tells you, the first equation, that the price vector of the various commodities is nothing but the costs of production, the material costs of production, that's A, the input material input matrix times the price vector, plus the wage rate times the labor input vector, in brackets, total costs, times 1 plus R. Now the assumption here is there's a uniform rate of profits on the capital advance in the system, and this is of course an assumption justified by Smith in terms of free competition. No barriers to entry into a market and no barriers to exit from a market. It's not a situation Smith would have found in Scotland or England at the time. It's an idea to some extent. But that is the price vector for a given technology, A and L. You get that price vector. Now you can measure prices in terms of a standard of value. Say D is such a commodity bundle times P is equal to unity, and whatever happens to income distribution, R and W, the rate of profits and the wage rate, that bundle gives you the value 1, and everything is measured in terms of that bundle. Now you can immediately go to labor commanded prices, and labor commanded prices are nothing but those prices divided by the wage rate. Because if you divide by the wage rate, you get the amount of labor, the price is W per unit, which you can command by being the proprietor of one unit of a particular commodity. Is that clear? Yeah, seems to be clear. So the price vector with a little zero there, these are labor commanded prices. Now you see, if the rate of profits happens to be zero, that is, all the surplus product generated in the system is distributed in terms of wages, then labor commanded prices are the same as labor embodied quantities. The next equation, V, gives you the labor embodied vector values. And of course, that's nothing but the labor embodied in the means of production, used up in the course of production, A times V, plus the net labor added, right? So you can see if R equals zero, P zero equals V. Now, clearly P, the labor commanded prices, are larger than labor embodied values, if and only if the rate of profits is positive. And you can show, this is a little exercise, that if the rate of profits increases, labor commanded prices deviate from labor embodied values more and more. So the derivative of labor commanded prices with regard to the rate of profits is positive. The final thing. Now this is something you find in Schraffer. Piero Schraffer, he was mentioned early on. And indeed, Schraffer commented on his invention of the standard commodity, eventually, as follows. The standard commodity should be found to be equivalent to the standard suggested by Adam Smith, namely, labor commanded. So he relates his concept immediately to the Smithian concept of labor commanded, and therefore to the relationship to power. This expresses power. Now, what we have got in Schraffer, you might all know this because I know at JNU the book by Schraffer is read all the time. You didn't do that, you should do it. At any rate, what Schraffer shows is that any given conditions of production, a system of production, so to speak, defined in terms of an A matrix and L labor input vector, boils down to an inverse relationship between the actual rate of profits R and the share of wages omega. And it is linear if you use the standard commodity. It is linear. Capital R is the maximum rate of profits compatible with the system. If no wages would be paid, the rate of profits would be equal to capital R, the maximum rate of profits. Now, again, what you can see, you can express the value of the net product in terms of labor commanded. So you divide by W, you get that second relationship, you differentiate with regard to the rate of profits, and what you're getting, and that is eventually the expression of power in a Smithian, Sraffian, classical system, you can see as R increases from zero for a given system of production, the labor commanded value increases. Power is getting larger. And of course, the rate of profits, the actual rate of profits, can asymptotically go towards the maximum rate of profits. And then, of course, power, so to speak, becomes almost infinite, because what matters is the intercept at the y-axis for any given R and from the curve and one that is the value of the net social product in case there is no rate of profits, you just measure in terms of labor embodied values. Do you understand the argument? Is it clear? Yes, some people are giving a sign that it is clear, which is wonderful. I must say this is the best audience I've ever had. Okay, now, Smith, of course, dealt with the concept of power in terms also of a theory of social and economic states of society. The first one is the original state of things. There is no means of production to any great degree. There is no appropriation of land. And in this case, the worker, his argument goes, gets the entire product. Once private property of land takes hold, then a part of the product generated by workers is appropriated by landlords on the basis of private property of land. And he argues landlords reap where they never sowed. Rent is a price of that sort. And then if there is a capitalist society with means of production, then there's a second deduction from the produce of labor, and that is profit. And you see, you now have a three-class society with wages, profits, rents, and that has to be explained as his analysis expands. Now he points out very clearly that there is no harmony amongst the various classes of society, and in particular, there is a dispute over wages. The interests of workers and capitalists, he argues, are by no means the same. The workmen desire to get as much, the masters to give as little as possible. The former are disposed to combine in order to raise, the latter in order to lower the wages of labor. So there's a conflict. It's a conflict over the distribution of income, over working conditions and whatnot. And he continues, now which of the two parties will, in all probability under given circumstances, prevail? And he argues that the answer is simple at the time at which he wrote. Because masters, as he calls them, capital owners, are able to force the other into compliance with their terms. Why? First, there's the collective action problem. The masters, being fewer in number, can combine much more easily. Secondly, of course, policy. Economic policy, social policy matters. The law besides authorizes or at least does not prohibit their combinations, while it prohibits those of the workmen. And third, in all such disputes, the masters can hold out much longer. If there's a conflict, they have the means and ways, so to speak, to survive, whereas workers after a short while are already in difficulty. So they are asymmetries, various asymmetries, Smith points out, which are at the basis of the power relationship here, right? It's very clear, I think. And what he also emphasizes, which I think is interesting, masters are always and everywhere in a sort of tacit but constant and uniform combination, not to raise the wages of labor. And he goes on, we seldom indeed hear of this combination because it is the usual, and one may say, the natural state of things, which nobody ever hears of. You see, I spoke about the fact that power walks on silent paws. It is there, but you don't see it, you don't hear it, you don't notice it. But nevertheless, it is there. And Smith was clear, very clear about it. And of course, one of the reasons why there are these power asymmetries is there are information asymmetries. According to Smith, which is interesting, you might look that up, you may define different social classes also in terms of their access, the members' access to information, knowledge, and understanding of what is going on. And he argues that typically workers, little educated, etc., etc., they don't have the access to the information. Even if they had it, they could not make that much sense of it. Therefore, they can easily be victims of people who are good orators and tell them they should follow those orators, such as, for example, if I may say, a current American president. So, you see, there is this problem. There is the problem of opinion dynamics and of the capture of minds, right? In the public deliberation, the worker's voice is little heard and less regarded, except upon some particular occasions. And listen now, when his clamor is animated, set on and supported by his employers, not for his, but their own particular purposes. That's all Smith, you see. Smith is just wonderful. Read him. He's a great author, and what we learn about him in ordinary textbooks, who always try to portray him as if he was, so to speak, a forerunner, a precursor of neoliberalism, it's all rubbish. Okay, now, he also points out that as regards economic policy, it's difficult occasionally to really follow those suggestions made by dealers and market intermediaries, because their interest is not the public interest, but the private interest. And you must differentiate between the two. Therefore, the proposal of any new law or regulation of commerce which comes from this order of man ought always to be listened to with great precaution, and ought never to be adopted till after having been long and carefully examined, not only with the most scrupulous, but with the most suspicious attention. This is not Marx who talks to you. This is Adam Smith, the Adam and Smith of political economy, right? So, you see, these suggestions come from an order of men, he goes on, I mean, who have generally an interest to deceive and even oppress the public, and who accordingly have upon many occasions both deceived and oppressed it. Adam Smith, The Wealth of Nations, 1776. So in short, one can also show that Smith anticipated the concept, not the words, of asymmetric information, moral hazard, and adverse selection. And this is particularly with regard to the banking and financial sector. And he argued that in the interest of the security of the whole society, this sector has to be regulated. And not only once for all, because, you see, people are ingenious in trying to circumnavigate certain rules. It is a long-standing task, right? And he points out that whilst this is a violation of natural liberty, it is perfectly justified. The security of the whole society is more important than the gains and the success of single individuals. So, you see, Smith understood very well that an analysis of institutions is important, and one case in point is, of course, and you here in India might like to read that, his analysis of the East India Company, a monopoly, right? And all the damage it caused. He was very critical of it. He did not argue that trade, if carried out by such institutions, is a good thing. No. I mean, I've just given a talk on that issue in another place here in India. He's very critical of what happened at the time. Now, finally, or almost finally, he implied that persistent deviations of natural from natural prices are a sign of the existence of monopolies, and he argued that the wretched spirit of monopoly, trying to get any particular conditions, privileges, etc., is always at work. And you might even ask yourself, as a firm, as a company, whether to invest in improvements, innovations, or in the establishment of a monopoly, rent-seeking. Make a calculation. Where do you have larger opportunities to make profits? And he's very clear that very often people engage in these kind of activities, namely building, I mean, monopolies, which are then, of course, very strong, very powerful. They don't allow others to enter the market, and so on and so forth. And he also discussed, last but not least, what later on the Marshall called class conflicts versus trade conflicts. There's on the one hand, of course, a conflict, as we just saw, between workers and masters, as he called them, capitalists, but there might also be conflicts within the class of capitalists. Moneyed man, the financial sector, as opposed to the industrial sector, the agricultural sector, and you can easily portray that in terms of, say, a given real wage rate, omega here, and differential rates of profit, right? R1, R2. This sale there gives you all the possibilities of sharing out a given product given the system of production in use. Now, if you want to have a higher rate of return on capital, as for example the financial sector, CEO Ackermann, Deutsche Bank, you might recall that, he once gave a speech and said, well, we want to have at least 25% net rate of return on the capital invested. It was very clear that this was, so to speak, a declaration of war, also to other sectors, the industrial sector, etc. And what we really observed in more recent times is that profitability is very much affected in various branches by well, laws, regulations, no regulations, and so on and so forth. You find the basic ideas there in Smith. Ricardo, very quickly. Now, Ricardo was, of course, analytically much advanced relative to Smith. There's no doubt about that. He insisted that profits come out of the surplus produce, and he coined the famous fundamental law of distribution, namely that there's an inverse relationship, we have just seen it already, which you find in Smith, but then there are statements which cast doubt on whether he was so clear about it. There's an inverse relationship between the rate of profits and the share taken by the workers. Now, he insisted, as opposed to Smith, because Smith had no theory of differential rent, he insisted that rent is not due, as Smith argued, or the physiocrats did so, is not due to the generosity of nature, because nature is so productive, but it is due to its niggardliness. If you have a competitive system which forces producers to cost minimize, then they will employ at first the most fertile plots of land and will employ only the less fertile plots of land when demand rises, population increases, and so on and so forth. So rent comes up when the niggardliness of nature makes an appearance. It's not necessarily a monopoly price, Ricardo added, but a phenomenon encountered also in conditions of free competition. He was clear that the rent divided the interest rate gives you the price of land. That is the famous formula of the perpetual rent, isn't it? It's all Ricardo. I mean, he was absolutely marvelous. And he added, these are my words, but that's what he said basically, rents are effortless incomes tied to the legal institution of private property and caused by the dynamism of the economy. That's important, by the dynamism of the economy. The property of land gives power to landlords, which increases with economic growth as the scarcity of land increases. You see, they're not doing anything, but their rents are going up. So it's a pure power phenomenon, right? Okay, that is Ricardo. Now, Ricardo also was the first author to have a fairly sophisticated analysis of technical change, the role of innovations, of new methods of production. And he pointed out, of course, reflecting to some extent the empirical situation in Great Britain at the time, the movement of the Luddites, those who destroyed machinery because they felt that machines destroy jobs, which of course is true to some extent, no doubt. In the third edition of the Principles, he came up with the idea that the substitution of machinery for human labor is often very injurious to the interests of the class of laborers. Technical progress may spell trouble for workers. It may also spell trouble, of course, for other capitalists who are using the old methods of production. Remember Schumpeter's concept of creative destruction. It's there all the time, you see. This is not a harmonious process, technical progress, innovations. There are always winners, but there are losers as well. Now, as regards Ricardo, prior to the third edition, he was of the opinion that maximizing profits is at the same time maximizing employment. But he now understood that that was wrong. You might get a smaller employment, but a larger surplus product appropriate in terms of profits, and he argued that the same cause which may increase the net revenue of the country, profits and rents, may at the same time render the population redundant and deteriorate the condition of the laborer. He was very clear about that. And this is the form of technical progress he had in mind. You see, labor productivity would increase, which means an increase in the maximum wage rate possible with the system at a zero rate of profits. At the same time, the maximum rate of profits would decline, which does not mean that the actual rate of profits need to decline. This is the form of technical progress upon which Ricardo, I would argue, founded his law of the falling rate of profits. And Ricardo pointed out that machines, this is interesting, are the mute agents of production. You see, machines don't ask for higher wages, better working conditions. They are mute. This might be quite useful if you want to avoid certain conflicts. And Ricardo contemplated in 1821, dear colleagues, in 1821, a fully automated system. He wrote, if machinery could do all the work that labor now does, there would be no demand for labor. Nobody would be entitled to consume anything who was not a capitalist and who could not buy or hire a machine. Now, if current forms of technical progress think about what is known as Industry 4.0, or cyber-physical systems, or the Internet of Things, the automation process that is going on, if that leads in that direction, then you get two problems. First, employment, or rather unemployment, and secondly, that workers are in trouble, because if unemployment goes up, you can be fairly sure, if it goes up to a large extent, that wages are in danger. And of course that means that in such situations, the state, government, economic, social policy must try to somehow cope with the situation in order to avoid really very, very dramatic situations that might come up. Now, improved machinery, Ricardo was clear, is a device used by firms in the competitive struggle. But it also affects the balance of power between the classes of society, of course. Smith had that famous phrase, in the long run the workman may be as necessary to his master is to him. You might recall that. But the necessity is not so immediate. In the case of a fully automated system, the necessity has vanished. It's gone. So things change as technology changes, as the structure of the economy changes. And he was also critic of the Bank of England's dealings. I don't go into details here because time, I think, is running very swiftly and there's still a few things to say. He was very critical of the Bank of England and was in favor of taking the issuing of paper currency away from it and eventually made a plan for the establishment of a proper national bank. The Bank of England was a private organization until almost the mid-20th century. Karl Marx. Now, Marx, of course, would give an opportunity to spend not only an entire lecture, but more than that, on the problem of power, etc. I don't have that. I give you only a few ideas you find in him and how they also relate to what we have heard already. Now, first of all, I think private property of the means of production, capital, land, natural resources, and its unequal distribution is the main source of power in capitalism. And he stressed the power of the ruling classes is based less on the exertion of force, which can be seen and felt, than on the quiet power, stille Macht is the German expression, of economic relationships. Again, you have the idea that is, you see, you must understand the backing of the system as a whole. Now, according to him, the history of mankind is essentially a history of class struggles. You know all this here at JNU. I'm not supposed to carry coal to Newcastle. But let me point out this. He actually adopted a particular version of the unintended consequences of human action, a very special kind, you might argue, of an invisible hand argument. He learned from the Scotsman and Hume. And as Adam Ferguson had pointed out, that is the beginning of the mid-18th century, history is the result of human action, but not the execution of any human design. And this recurs to some extent in Marx's recurrent formulation that things happen behind the backs of people, right? They have certain intentions, they try to make a lot of profits, but eventually the rate of profits, he argued, would fall. So it's behind the backs of agents. Something builds up, neither intended nor could be foreseen, which in the end undermines the social status quo. So there are power relationships, but at the same time, they're eroding by the internal, the endogenous forces at work in the system under consideration. It's a dynamic point of view which you also found, as we have seen, in Smith prior to him. Now, there's the law of motion of capitalism. Marx argued that development of the productive forces of social labor is the historical task and justification of capital. This is just the way in which it unconsciously, once again, unconsciously, creates the material requirements of a higher mode of production. He counted upon a ruse of history. Precisely by squeezing ever larger surplus value profits out of workers, via the use of methods of production that exhibit larger and larger organic compositions of capital, capitalists unintentionally precipitate the birth of a classless society. That's the idea. No? The basic idea. And obviously, the law of the tendency of the rate of profits has assumed a central stage in all this. This is, so to speak, the effect of selfish behavior, but which ends up in the end in a state of affairs which is rather different from the one which was sought. And he assumed, and he learned from Ricardo, I think, that a particular form of technical progress is at the back of all this. And it's the kind of progress Ricardo contemplated in machinery. But whereas in Ricardo that kind of technical progress is one of many other forms, Marx felt that it is the dominant form, which is congenial to the capitalist mode of production. I'm not going into a discussion of that now, no time. Now, important aspects of Marx are, of course, these: alienation, commodity, fetishism, and false consciousness. That is, what do people in societies, as the one in which he lived and we live, perhaps, really understand of what's going on, and who understands what? And the argument is that the kind of society and the ideology that is building up creates a false consciousness of things. It misreads reality in a fundamental way. Human beings are inclined to attribute supernatural features to commodities, money and capital, as if capital, for example, could by itself create profits. That is to say, the exploitative character of the system, according to Marx, is thus concealed. Now, he wrote about the financial sector, but the guy who really tried to get more down to the more recent developments was, vis-a-vis the rise of stock joint companies, Rudolf Hilferding. Das Finanzkapital, financial capital. And at the center of his discussion was promoters' profits, that is, banks acting as promoters of joint stock companies and then making huge profits, potentially, and also what he pointed out is as regards an aspect of the power issue, banks with interlocking assets, banks are able to control a much larger capital than their equity capital. You own a little firm, that firm owns a little other firm, and so on and so forth. So all of a sudden, you have a bank that possibly controls an enormous share of the capital in the system as a whole. And what Hilferding also points out is this. There emerged a new financial aristocracy, a new variety of parasites in the shape of promoters, speculators, and simply nominal directors. A whole system of swindling and cheating by means of corporation promotion, stock insurance, and stock speculation, this private production without the control of private property. Now, this could have been written recently as a comment on the financial crisis. No? It rings a bell, doesn't it? Now, this was in 1910. So, you find similar ideas, I have no time to elaborate on them, of course, in Kaletsky, and particularly his concept of the political business cycle. I won't go into that. I will also not go into land as power. Land was always considered from the very beginning as a potential source of power. Land in private property and an unequal distribution of it. But the interesting thing I wanted to point out here is that the idea that land should be public property can be traced back to many authors, and even some of them very famous marginalist authors. Hermann Heinrich Gossen, have you come across that guy? 1854, German, for a long time was completely unknown until Varas discovered the book. You know perhaps Gossen's law, the law of the diminishing marginal utility when you increase consumption and stuff like that. An important author, now he pointed out that private property of land and its unequal distribution prevents the realization of paradise on earth. Paradise on earth, you see. Don't wait, so to speak, for a new life elsewhere. On earth, just you need, so to speak, the state to buy the land from the private owners right now, of course raising taxes on the basis of rents. That's a kind of expropriation of the landowners. Similarly, Leon Walras, who called himself a scientific socialist, he advocated basically the same view, as did his father. Now there are other guys, I will not go into detail, of course, Henry George, the American economist, Franz Oppenheimer, a German economist, very influential as regards the kibbutzing movement, and his concept of land monopoly, which he felt was the major source of all, so to speak, all the misery of the working classes. Different from Marx, he criticized Marx. Achille Loria in Italy, Theodor Herzl, and Bertrand Russell and others. So land as an issue of great importance. Now briefly to Bimbabwe. So far we have talked about people who all thought that power plays a role, and they identify sources of power. They also spoke about the working of the system as a whole and how it reproduces power relationships. Now let's come to Eugen von Bimbabwe. He was certainly not the first and the only one to argue that power must not be a concern of economists. It's a locus classicus of the debate, namely his essay, 1914, My Counterposition. Now he was discussing at the time a theory of income distribution, which in German was known as a social theory of income distribution, so soziale Verteilungstheorie. Now major advocates, the people like Robertus, Stolzmann Lexis, some of you might know the names from reading Marx, Tugan Baranovsky in Russia, etc., etc. They insisted that institutions, social forces, etc., mattered a lot. Now, when Bauwerk asked the question, is the all-important problem of distribution of income, well, subject to natural laws, economic laws, or to the arbitrary influence of social forces? That's the question. And, of course, the first thing we might ask ourselves, which natural economic laws does he mean? I mean, it's not self-evident. What are the laws? And it is clear what he means is a particular theory that postulates laws, right? Laws are not just there, inscribed, so to speak, in the economy, but it's us economists coming up with the ideas of what is a law and how things are regulated. And what does he mean? He means the law of supply and demand and his particular Austrian form of marginal productivity theory. That's what he means. And then he basically comes up, if you read his article, with two main propositions. The first one is, yes, in the short run, power certainly has some impact on distribution. That cannot be denied. But this influence works through and via those laws, not against them. So you must understand, so to speak, power relationship via economic laws and how these relationships affect the working of the laws. And eventually, I mean, what he argues is the impact of power is reflected in a deviation of factor prices from the values of marginal productivities, of course. If you are a marginal productivity theorist, that's what you would come up with. But more importantly is the second main proposition, and it reads, in the medium and long run, and very often in the very medium run, he argued, any power will erode because the monopoly rents it offers will attract agents and intensify competition. Right? So power is a transient phenomenon. He insists there is no case in which the artificial intervention could be of lasting importance. A very strong claim. And concluded, economists are well advised to develop their reasoning in terms of the assumption of perfect competition and deal with deviations from it only if necessary and in short-run analysis. Right? So, capitalists are as powerless as workers, at least in the medium and long run, and profitability is simply a reflection of the marginal product of capital. That's the argument. That's, so to speak, really the stronghold of the kind of theory he was advocating. Now, some people did not completely buy Bauwerk's argument, said, well, maybe power relationships are more lasting, and therefore they try to analyze what it means, and the people I have in mind are, amongst others, Arthur Cecil Pigou and Abba Lerner. They come up with the concept of degree of monopoly, which is simply the ratio between the price of a product, its marginal cost, divided the price. And of course, if marginalism results, the numerator would be zero, and therefore there is no power. And clearly enough, if other things dominate, then it is possible that capitalists exploit workers, but it is also possible that workers exploit capitalists. And this can be shown quickly by referring to the price of a unit of factor service I, Q sub I, which is determined in the following way, Q sub I equals the marginal product of that resource times the price of the product times 1 minus 1 over epsilon. Epsilon is the price elasticity of demand, and then times 1 plus 1 over ni to the power of minus 1, and this is the elasticity of supply. And clearly enough, if and only if the two Greek things equal infinity, infinitely elastic, right? Then marginal theory dominates. Otherwise, it doesn't. And you see immediately So if, for example, trade unions are able to have some impact on the system, then the wage rate will be larger than the marginal product of labor times the price of the product. This will result in unemployment. It is, so to speak, trade union determined unemployment, the usual story goes. Now, clearly enough, the theory is acceptable if and only if it is correct, it can be sustained. I have no time to enter into a discussion. Is marginal productivity theory sustainable? According to some critics, and particularly Pirozaf, I think he's the most important critic we have seen, and Krishna explained very beautifully his argument, it cannot be sustained, in particular because the concept of capitalism, magnitude of size, can be known independently of and prior to the determination of prices, and the rate of profits cannot be sustained. So let me briefly go to Friedrich von Wieser. Now, Friedrich von Wieser, you see, was the, what is it, is it brother-in-law? Yes, the brother-in-law of Böhm-Bawerk. They were very close. And Wieser actually played an important role in the elaboration of the marginalist theory of value and distribution. He coined the term in German, marginal utility. And he also had a theory of marginal productivity, and he combined the two in the 1880s. A very important author. But at the same time, he saw that as regards the Austrian variant of that theory, Karl Menger's in particular, there's a problem, and that is the imputation problem. Are you familiar with that problem? No. Well, the idea is the Austrians, you see, they typically argue that you must not come from cost of production as the classicals, labor, etc. You must come from the needy individual, the Robinson Crusoe. And a thing has value if and only if individuals attribute value to it. And they typically start in a recursive manner. They assume that the prices of consumption goods are indeed determined by individuals who attribute those values to the prices. Now, if that is the case, you have a vector of, say, consumer goods prices, then the problem is you had costs in order to produce those goods. How does the price, so to speak, split up in the cost of production, of material inputs, wages, blah, 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 and so on and so forth. Is it clear? That's the imputation problem. How do we trace back, so to speak, to the inputs, to the factors of production, that given price? And he showed Menger that Menger had no real solution. And then he started to discuss a system in which there is the production of commodities by means of commodities, very early. And he found out that under certain circumstances, you see, the surplus product may be the same with regard to each and every commodity generated. And that means that the surplus product, relative to the amount of these commodities as inputs, gives you directly a physical rate of return on capital. Right? That's what he saw. I mean, of course, he was shocked by that because it undermined his entire analysis, but I think that was the starting point of his considerations about power and the law of power. And with his book, particularly in, Das Gesetz der Macht, he produced an antithesis to Böhm-Bawerk. Böhm-Bawerk, you see, was power or, what was it, Macht oder ökonomisches Gesetz, power or economic laws. Wieser now comes and argues the law of power, exactly opposed to Böhm-Bawerk. He was very much under the influence of the French and other guys, of course, social psychologists, Gustave Le Bon, the crowd, and he took issue with the individualistic doctrine and the social contract theory, arguing that the allegedly felicific unlimited freedom does not exist. It does not exist in any society in which people live. And then he distinguished between what he called exterior powers, which are normally discussed, and attention focuses on them, wealth, money, physical and military force, and so on and so forth, as opposed to interior powers, inside people, the general consciousness, the state of the mind, and so on and so forth. And he argued that the relationship between social elites and the masses is based first and foremost on inner powers. That is to say, he argued, inner powers constitute the core of the phenomenon of power in societies. Whoever is able to capture the minds of many people is powerful and capable of using resources above and beyond his own possessions. And he counterposed two laws. The first is the law of the small number of great men. These are the powerful, right? The law of the small number of great men. And the other one is the law of the large number of small men. These are the homo economici. No? The powerless people. And this foreshadows indeed, I think, the analysis of opinion formation and dynamics. Now Schumpeter, Mibisa was Schumpeter's teacher, and several of the ideas are to be found in Schumpeter as well. And of course I cannot go into details here. At any rate, Schumpeter was very clear about the fact that you see, the separation between demanders and suppliers, and the idea in Marshall that supply and demand functions are independent of one another, is difficult to sustain, because typically what firms do, they try to shape the preferences of agents, and occasionally they're quite successful in doing so. As John Maurice Clark put it, in any firm you have two departments. One department produces the needs and wants of people, and the other department produces the goods to satisfy the needs and wants. Now, if you have got that, of course, the two functions, supply and demand, are not independent of one another. What then? And you see, I started with general equilibrium theory. Kenneth Arrow, who died recently, you may have heard about that, this greatest, I think, of all general equilibrium theorists, and enormously intelligent man who has given wonderful ideas in various fields. He gave a talk in Austria 3 years ago at the Austrian Central Bank. I met him there. And there in the flyer, it is stated, a key factor in the organization of the economy is the set of beliefs that people have about each other. They change those beliefs by searching, by computing, by analyzing, you might also say by influencing, by exerting power. And when looked at properly, this gives rise to some considerable anomalies. When compared with the standard theories, he means his general equilibrium theory, and I and many others have developed. So in some sense, I'm finding some difficulty with work I've done in the past. He distanced himself, to some extent, from the previous work, and also the Nobel Prize he got for that work. Right, because he's a man who really thinks. I think it's important to see that. So let me conclude. Power is a pervasive phenomenon and a source of inequality, of income, wealth, race, gender, etc. The sources of asymmetries between people, power, are often not easy to see. They're embodied in institutions, norm, rules, regulations, privileges, and the working of the game of the system, which are supported by beliefs, ideologies, and theories that reinforce them. A study of power necessitates a study of the role of those institutions and the formation of opinions and ideologies as their protective belts. It requires a study of the working of the system as a whole. This we have already heard. If resources can successfully employ to change other people's preferences, views, etc., then offend the fundamental assumption of, for example, welfare economics, does not hold any longer. The autonomy of individuals and, if you wish, the immaculate conception of their preferences. Right? They are the result of the social fabric rather than a primitive datum. Finally, if economic power gets more and more concentrated, an irreconcilable contradiction becomes ever more pronounced between the democratic logic of one vote to one vote, and the market logic of $1, one vote. And I think democracy, in many places of the world, is in danger of becoming an empty shell. Krishna. I'm sure knew most of what was touched upon in this talk, and she may have approved of some of the propositions put forward. She was a great scholar. Thank you very much indeed.